Well, good morning and welcome to our service here at ABC. I'm Ashley, one of the ministers at the church. And as you join us online, I want to welcome you. And I hope you will be inspired, encouraged and blessed by being with us here today. If this is your first time with us, or perhaps one of the first times you've joined us, we'd love to be in contact with you. So please send in an email to the church email address, which is info@altringhambaptist.org. Of course, you can find out about not just the services, but everything in our church life by heading to our church website, which is altringhambaptist.org.
Hi, I'm Andrew, also one of the ministers here at Altrincham Baptist Church. We believe that prayer makes a real difference in the many situations we all face in our lives. We have a team of people in the church committed to praying for others, and if there is anything that you would like them to pray for, please send an email to prayer@altringhambaptist.org, and we will ask the team to pray for your need. And we can do that anonymously if you would prefer. If you would like someone to pray with you over the phone, please let us know and provide your contact details and someone will call you.
Well, it's about time to start. We hope that you'll be really blessed by joining us this morning.
Good morning, good morning. Morning to all of you here who I can see. Morning, Phil. Morning to all of those you I can see face to face. Morning to those of you on Zoom this morning. Good to, can't see you, but I know you're there, so good to have you here with us this morning. Wasn't it lovely last week, those of you who are here in person, those of you on Zoom, when we were able to sing for that first time, for those of you who were singing without masks, you could feel the volume, couldn't you, around the church? Now, as ever, the rules are, if you would like to wear a mask, please do. If you prefer not to, no need at this moment. So we're going to have some more song worship this morning. Really looking forward to hearing your voices. Those of you who love harmonies, really looking forward to that too. We've got three songs for you at the beginning, and then we're going to create some space for you to come and share your stories of this week gone by, these last few weeks. So as we're singing and we're praising God, just think about those things that you'd like to bring forward to talk about your experiences with God, talk about this, where you are right now, and Ashley will lead us in that, but it'd be really good to just bless and encourage each other with those stories of how God has walked with us in these past few weeks. So shall we stand, if we're able, and we'll start our sung worship. Thank you. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of the whole kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay it down in life. That I would be set free.
Conquered the grave. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King.
Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that you have made a way, Father, that you have brought us to this place this morning, Lord. Thank you, Father, that no matter what state we're in, no matter how our week has been or what it's going to be, that here, right now, we can meet with you, Lord.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear.
And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life,
I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me.
And if my God is with me, whom then shall we you for the truth of that, Father. I mean, these words were written way before this time that we've just all been living through and are living through, Lord. But for the heart that holds on, Lord. And we want to acknowledge this morning, Lord, that our hearts are holding on because of you. Not because of us, not because of our strength, but your strength, Lord. And we find ourselves in that place again where we just want to open up our hearts, Father, and say, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us to this point. Thank you, Lord, no matter how tenuous, no matter how strong. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us to this place. In your hands, Father. In your hands. We've got many stories amongst us this morning. We've got many stories. And one of the difficulties of being the person with the mic is the temptation is for me to fill the gap. But actually, amongst us, God's been moving. And it would be just wonderful to hear from each of us. So Ash is going to come and he's going to give us that opportunity to hear from all of us.
Yep, there we go. Great. Great to see you. My name's Ashley, one of the ministers in the church. And I wanted to just spend a bit of time because Thursday night, we had a kind of church family gathering here. And we spent a chunk of time in that time together listening to ideas that we might have on how we might facilitate a greater sense of community. Helen's just been talking about how that's been impacted and affected by the pandemic. We're distanced, we've now got our masks off and everything. So I wondered about how we might facilitate more community, more sharing, more being family together. And one person suggested what we really could do with is spend some more time just telling stories about things that have happened that have gone on in our lives. So, always to do the band sitting down now. Here is some space, here is some time to do that. And I wanted to invite anybody who's just got something they want to share about how God has spoken, moved, helped, aided, challenged, whatever, over the last week, months, and share that today. So, I'm going to hop down here, because you won't be on your own, you'll be with me. So, can someone come and share a story? Of course you can. get to the mic and introduce yourself.
So I'm just going to get the ball rolling because I'm quite bold and quite confident. And as I said to my friend on the phone, if we've got to 48 and you can't say it out loud and proud, you know, you need to have a word with yourself, don't you? It's like, so so I just wanted to say just a little bit about starting here at ABC as a children and families worker. Most of you know I worked in the NHS for a very long time working with children and families there, and now I have the pleasure of being able to serve you guys and the wider community. And so one of my big things was my pension. I know it sounds silly, but you know, I'm a single parent to two children, and you have to think about the long-term implications of big moves and stuff. And I just kind of was in this kind of thing of, well, if I have a 5-year break in the NHS, then that's okay, because I can go back in on the same terms, and I could always pay into something else for now, and then I can transfer that over at a later date. And it was kind of just whizzing around in my head, and I sought some advice from different people. And I kind of felt very much like I was in this limbo about how much I was committing to here based on my pension. Does that make sense? So I just put my head down in church, in the office the other day, and I just said, God, what is it? For what time? For what season? For what is being here now? And you'd have thought I'd done this before filling in the application form, wouldn't you? But, but anyway, God works in mysterious ways. And the two words I got is bed in and deep roots. And so there I was, and I have it written down in my diary if you want physical proof, that the words I got was bed in and deep roots. And then the lovely church families sent me a welcome gift, which had a little card that said rooted in faith and a lovely plant that said we're rooting for you. And I was like, whew. Now, the verse that was prayed at my children's dedication was from Ephesians, for this reason I kneel before the Father, you know, that one that says that you being rooted and established in love would grasp how high and how wide. Oh, I'm shaking. Sorry. It's the love of Christ Jesus. And that was my prayer for my kids, was that they would be rooted and established in love. I'm actually making everything shake, right? I'll try and brace myself. So the verses kept them flowing about, and I kind of carried on to praying about through this idea of roots and what was God's ministry to these children, to these young people. And it was that they would know that they are rooted and established in love, and they would be like those trees that it talks about in Psalm 1, I think, yep, where it has the deep roots by the water, that they would grow and they would flourish and thrive. And when the winds come, they would not be shaken in their faith. And then also Colossians, I think it's... I've forgotten it now. I should have written it down. But I think it's around Colossians 2, where it talks about being rooted in your faith and being grounded. And that's kind of set really my heart for the children's ministry, which in a way I kind of had the social model in my head, but actually the spiritual model. So just pray for these young people because they are totally awesome. And pray for these mums and dads who nurture these kids because they are the future of the church, of God, and help us as a family just to nurture those roots so they are deep, so when the winds come, they will not be shaken. Great. So that's just my heart for now. So.
Fantastic, thank you. I know there's more stories, it's just you having the courage to come and share them. You know what Rachel just did for you all in terms of encouraging faith? Anyone who comes up just does that. So, any other stories? Yep, here he comes. Stephen and then Helen. Long way. Stephen.
Thanks. I had a really bad week last week. Friday morning was probably the culmination of it, as Rachel will bear testimony to, because I was with her on Friday morning, and it wasn't a good time for either of us, I think. But I told her I was due to go to Haydock Park races. I'm a big racing fan, and I'm not bragging, but I have a share in a racehorse. So racing is is my number one love after God. I've been to Haydock no end of times, but it was very busy. So I decided I would try a detour, and I got lost. I don't have sat nav, and when I get lost, I get very, very angry, as Annie, my wife, will tell you. And I was totally lost. I knew I was close, but I was no idea where I was heading for, or where I wanted to go. And I stopped, and I prayed. And I shouted out, as only David can shout out, God, please, please help me. And I went another 100 yards, and I knew I wanted to be on the 580. And 100 yards down the road, there was a sign 580. And I said, thank God for that. And another 100 yards down the road on the left was the entrance to Haydock Park Racecourse. Now, I'd never been to a head-up part race course from that direction ever before. And I just thank God. Now, I wasn't for the, it's unusual this, but I wasn't really looking forward to that particular afternoon. And I had the most wonderful day's racing I think I've ever had. And I've been to probably 500 race meetings in my life, and that was the finest afternoon I've ever had. I met people who I just fell in love with as people, and I won't bore you with all the details, but I was actually reduced to tears that afternoon, and it was all thanks to God.
Bless you.
Amen.
Thanks, Dan. Helen.
Thank you. Sort of linking back to what Rachel said, really, about roots. Sorry, don't like mics.
Hard luck.
Says me. Linking back to what Rachel said about roots, I was at a funeral on Friday, and I was talking with my cousin about our childhood and how idyllic it was in many ways, because there was like four families that used to be together, all Christians, and we were brought up in the faith, and we were brought up together, all my cousins, we were in 5 years, born of each other. And I just want to praise God and give testimony to God that roots, those roots have brought me where I am here today. Yeah. And it's, yeah, thank you, God.
That's brilliant, brilliant. And further, Mandy's going to come up. And there is time, so if you want to share a story, please come and share us that a story. But here's Mandy.
I've had a difficult 2 weeks because my dad died, and I'd just like to say thank you to the church family here for all their kindness and love, the Bradleys, and for you praying with me. And then this morning, which was really, really nice, Gordon, he's got a bad knee and a bad toe, he's at the hub, and he came across specially to see me, to check I was all right. So that was really, really nice. So, brilliant. You know, there's a wonderful church family here that have given me a lot of love, and I really thank you all for that. So thank you.
Great. Thanks, Mandy. Range of stories. Anyone else? John. Great. John's Helen's dad, so a bit of a family thing going on here, so this is great. John.
Forgive me if I'm emotional. We have life, life abundant. I was with Helen at the funeral on Friday of Ruth's sister's husband, but he was a Christian. He's not dead. He is alive.
Yes.
Alive forevermore. We have life.
Absolutely.
We have life. It struck me on Friday more than ever. We have life abundant, life eternal. And people don't realize this. We shall spread it abroad. We have life. Jesus died so that we might have life. The funeral wasn't dead.
No.
The funeral was alive.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
People there, it was Lynn Baptist, actually.
Yeah.
But all the Christians around,
fantastic.
They weren't sorry. They were sorry for Beatrice, for the family.
Yeah.
But there was no sorrow. It was alive. Jesus is alive and we have life. Life abundant. And that's what it's time we realized this and did something about it. We have life.
Brilliant.
And life abundant.
Fantastic.
Because Jesus died for us. Sorry, I'm emotional.
No. Bless you, John. Bless you, John. Just want to bring all these stories that we've heard and the ones that are perhaps could have been told here to our Father. Lord, these are testimonies. They are stories about your work in the world today. They are stories about care. They are stories about hope and perspective. They are stories about truth over lies.
And Lord, we bless you for the fact that, as John just said, you are alive and you are active and working in us today. And we offer these prayers back to you, Lord, as a thanks offering for all that you are doing in us and through us these days. Be praised, Lord Jesus, for you are alive and we worship you. Amen. Great. Well, young'uns, you can go off to your groups now. So I think you can follow Rachel off that back way, I think. All those are going to slip away. I'm going to move back up here. Just before I lead us in prayer, I wanted to just flag up a couple of things. So what's happening this week? The one particular one is what's happening on Tuesday night here in this room, 8 o'clock. We'll have the second of our two evenings where we're looking at the Bible and LGBT inclusion. What does the Bible say on this, well, very contemporary subject? If you missed it last week or didn't get a copy of the notes, there is a pile of notes down here on the table. Come and grab one if that interests you. We looked last week at the Old Testament. This week we're looking at the New Testament and working out what the Bible says on this subject. Also, just from last week, on Thursday evening, we had a church family gathering. And just probably some good news out of that is that we've got Marge and Bence here. We had them up on the screen on Thursday, but Marge and Bence are our latest church members. We're delighted to have you as part of our church family, and they are already involved and doubtless will be increasingly involved in the life of the church over these coming months and years. So bless you for that. So let's pray. Bring to God concerns about our world, our corporate life as a church family, and then some stuff about ourselves as individuals. So let's pray. And Lord, as we've been praying over these last 2 months now, every Sunday about the situation in Ukraine, we bring that to you. We pray, Father, not to play military or political games, but we pray to the King of Kings that he might act. And as the scriptures tell us, bring an end to all wars, might act to bring peace in the country of Ukraine. We pray, Lord, for war to be thwarted. We pray for the worst manifestations of this war, for the harm that is done to minds and bodies and communities to stop. And we pray, Lord, that on this day, as millions around the world pray for peace, that your peace might be established in that country. We pray for Putin and all that he needs at this time. And we pray for Zelensky and all that he needs at this time. Speak and act, we ask in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for our own church community, our church family here. On Thursday, we kind of surveyed the scene of where church is, and the church nationally has gone through a tricky time and an up time of upheaval and change, and we recognize this, Father, but as much as that change has happened, we know that that change is not permanent, and the Church of Jesus Christ and the Kingdom of God continues to be active and working in this world. We pray for Andrew and the team over at the Hub right now, who are leading a bunch of people in the inclusion group, particularly people who are new to faith, on the fringe of faith, coming to discover faith. And we pray that that group might be a brilliant means and enabler of them to ask questions, to them hear the truth, for them to be worked on by your Spirit so you might draw them winsomely and in love to yourself and to the church family. We pray for the activities that happen each week, which are church, I guess, activities. And we thank you for our facilitation of much work around the Ukrainian guests who have come to this country. We thank you for the hub and the way that's been changed and remodeled over recent months, and for the work it is about now. Bless the new staff members who are coming on track there. Just for Rachel and Marge who are here, but for Vicky and for Peter as well, that they might find their feet and work effectively and well. And we pray, Lord, for this sense of community that, I guess, took a bit of a battering during the pandemic. But as things have changed, Father, help us to have the imagination, the God-given, Spirit-filled imagination to work out how we might restore community, be your people more fully, and fundamental to that, be witnesses to Jesus Christ in all that we do. And we pray for our own lives. We identify with David, already been referenced today. David, who in Psalm 51 pours out his heart in vulnerability and openness to his sin and failure. And we too are such failed people, and we seek your forgiveness today as we cast our minds back over the past week for the things that we've said or thought or done or not done, which meant that we denied you, we rebelled against you. Lord, in your love and your grace, according to your promise, forgive us, please, and restore us. Set our feet back on a rock. Deliver us from the past. Help us to shake off the things that have held us back, so that the week ahead may be full of newness and possibility and life. Lord, we pray about the things that we carry this morning, those burdens that perhaps just a few people share, or perhaps we hold on to ourselves. And Lord, we offer them to you now, and we ask for your help. Help, Lord, just as Rachel prayed in that office. And we pray in faith. We pray expecting change, expecting difference and newness, that those things that trouble us, those things perhaps that we've carried for so long, might be lifted from us, so that we can continue in our discipleship journey, following close on the heels of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. We pray particularly about our decision-making, our plans. Things seem to be moving so quickly. And Lord, sometimes life can feel out of control. So Lord, we bring to you now those things that are up for grabs, that we're thinking about, trying to think through. And we ask you for your guidance and your light at the crossroads we are facing. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are with us in this, that your presence transforms every situation. And we pray these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I speak to you for the next passage in Galatians chapter 3, I wanted to show a short video. It's a cartoon video, but it's got, to my mind, a very powerful message. You may have seen it before, you may not, no apologies. If you've seen it before, I've watched it many times, it still has a remarkable impact on me. It's got words on it, but it's bright in here, the words are very faint, but I hope you hear what's being said. And this is called the Sea Parable.
Thank you. On a dangerous sea coast where shipwrecks often occur, there was once a basic wee life-saving post. The building was just a glorified hut, and there was only one boat, but the handful of committed members kept a constant watch over the sea. There was no thought for themselves. They went out day and night, tirelessly searching for the lost. Many lives were saved by this wonderful wee place, so that it became famous. Some of those who were saved, and various others in the surrounding area, wanted to become associated with the station. The wee life-saving post grew. Some of the members of the life-saving post were unhappy that the building was so crude and poorly equipped. They felt that a more comfortable place should be provided as the first refuge of those saved from the sea. So they replaced the wee life-saving post with a larger building. Now it's become a popular gathering place for its members because they used it as a sort of club. Fewer members were now interested in going to sea on life-saving missions, so they hired lifeboat crews to do this work. About this time, a large ship was wrecked off the coast, and the hired crews brought in loads of cold, wet, and half-drowned people. The beautiful new club was in chaos, so the committee immediately had a separate shower house built outside the club, where victims of shipwrecks in the future could be cleaned up before coming inside. At the next meeting, there was a split in the club membership. Most of the members wanted to stop the club's life-saving activities as being unpleasant and a hindrance to the normal social life of the club. They were finally voted down and told that if they wanted to save lives of all the various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in those waters, they could begin their own life-saving post down the coast. They did. As the years went by, the new life-saving post experienced the same changes that had occurred in the old. It evolved into a club, and yet another life-saving post was founded. History continued to repeat itself, and if you visit that sea coast today, you'll find a number of exclusive clubs along the shore. Shipwrecks are frequent in those waters, but most of the people drown.
I've taken a bit of an unusual step today in that I want to bring you the reading from Galatians chapter 3 from the Message version of the Bible. So you might know the Message is it's not a literal translation, it's more of a paraphrase written by Eugene Peterson some 30 or 40 years ago. He wrote it for his church congregation to help them to kind of really access what was going on in the text. And the reason why this Sunday I'm choosing the Message version is because as I've read and reread the version in with the URSV, which is what I generally use, the language just seems really quite dense and hard to get by. And if we were doing a Bible study, perhaps I'd keep the URSV. But on a Sunday morning, we haven't got so much time, and I want us to just access this a bit more easier. So here is Galatians 3, 1-14, from the Message version. And as you know on the screen, it shows that our theme is no longer, the five no longers in the book of Galatians. So here we go, Galatians 3, 1-14. You crazy Galatians, did someone put a spell on you? Have you taken leave of your senses? Something crazy has happened, for it's obvious that you no longer have the crucified Jesus in clear focus in your lives. His sacrifice on the cross was certainly set before you clear enough. Let me put this question to you. How did your new life begin? Was it by working your heads off to please God, or was it by responding to God's message to you? Are you going to continue this craziness? For only crazy people would think they could complete by their own efforts what was begun by God. If you weren't smart enough or strong enough to begin it, how do you suppose you could perfect it? Did you go through this whole painful learning process for nothing? It is not yet a total loss, but it certainly will be if you keep this up. Answer this question. Does God, who lavishly provides you with his own presence, his Holy Spirit, working things in your lives you could never do for yourself, does he do these things because of your strenuous moral striving or because you trust him to do them in you? Don't these things happen among you just as they happened with Abraham? He believed God, and that act of belief was turned into a life that was right with God. Is it not obvious to you that persons who put their trust in Christ, not persons who put their trust in the law, are like Abraham, children of faith? It was all laid out beforehand in Scripture that God would set things right with non-Jews by faith. Scripture anticipated this in the promise to Abraham, all nations will be blessed in you. So now, those who live by faith are blessed along with Abraham, who lived by faith. This is no new doctrine. And that means that anyone who tries to live by his own effort, independent of God, is doomed to failure. Scripture backs this up. Utterly cursed is every person who fails to carry out every detail written in the book of the law. The obvious impossibility of carrying out such a moral program should make it plain that no one could sustain a relationship with God that way. The person who lives in right relationship with God does it by embracing what God arranges for him. Doing things for God is the opposite of entering into what God does for you. Habakkuk had it right. The person who believes God is set right by God, and that's the real life. Rule-keeping does not naturally evolve into living by faith, but only perpetuates itself in more and more rule-keeping, a fact observed in Scripture. The one who does these things, rule-keeping, continues to live by them. Last bit. Christ redeemed us from that self-defeating, cursed life by absorbing it completely into himself. Do you remember the scripture that says, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree? That's what happened when Jesus was nailed to the cross. He became a curse and at the same time dissolved the curse. And now because of that, the air is clear and we can see that Abraham's blessing is present and available for non-Jews too. We're all able to receive God's life, his spirit, in and with us by believing, just the way Abraham received it. So that film that I showed, Sea Parable, I love it. It always gets me every time. I get a bit emotional watching it. It tells a story which starts out with such incredible hope. There's that little band motivated by their concern for others out on the waters, the stormy sea, and they devote their energies to this building of a little small lifeboat station. And then at great personal cost to themselves, do this incredible work of going out in storms and saving lives at sea. But over time, something shifts. Energies and resources get redirected, attitudes changed, priorities reworked. Instead of mainly being focused on the work with the lost out on the sea, their attention becomes mainly focused on the activity of the members on dry land. So much so that when the group discuss what their priority should actually be, there's a split. With the result that a small number leave to start with the original intention and others remain in the now beautiful, luxurious clubhouse. And yet for them who break off, the cycle continues again of changing resources, changing energies and priorities, and that follows by a disagreement and a split and et cetera, et cetera. And it ends with two results. One result at the end of the film is that if you to visit that coastline today, you would find a small number of lifeboat stations still in existence along the coast. But also the more telling summary, that shipwrecks are frequent in these waters, but most of the people drown. In some way, I think that film tracks the message of what Paul's trying to say in this passage in Galatians, about a cycle that has now been established, which perhaps even we can learn from and affects our lives and faith and church activity today. And here's the cycle, as I think I understand it. Firstly, the law is given. Originally, the law is given to Moses on Mount Sinai, and then all those other laws, 613 of them, and that is how the people are to live. And I know the temptation is, because I've fallen for this myself, is to downplay this law and then big up the new covenant, the grace of Jesus Christ. But if we do that, and I've done this by mistake in the past, we denigrate this beautiful, brilliant, wonderful way in which God showed the people how to be at peace with him, with others, with themselves in this world. The law says you can be forgiven. The law says your sins can be removed. The law says there is reconciliation and peace to be had between us and God. And that's done by keeping the law which God gave to Moses. But therein lies the very problem itself. The problem's never been the law. We sometimes think, I know, why on earth did God give the law and then give us Jesus? Why didn't he just give us Jesus in the first place? The problem wasn't the law. The problem was our ability to keep the law and all these laws. Those who follow the law, though, ultimately, they lost perspective about that being reconciled to God and living in peace with God and being a light to the nations, and they drifted and they slid into a legalism. And that's the danger with laws, with legals, with legalism. You end up missing the point. You end up losing your way. Somewhat bizarrely, I've been fascinated by this news story. Fascinated by it. And I've come to the conclusion that the real victim in the Wagatha Christie case is, of course, Rebecca Vardy. She's the victim of wag culture, the victim of celebrity culture, the victim of the image of herself that she has constructed. My heart genuinely goes out to Rebecca Vardy because I think she is so, so lost. The law has been used in this case, but the law could never achieve what was really necessary. So as I said, the brilliant law is given, but we fail to keep it. And what we find is that there is a blockage. Remember this news story? That ship last year stuck in the Suez Canal, run by the company Evergreen. A gigantic blockage for, what was it, 2 weeks down the Suez Canal. The great irony, of course, is that the ship itself is there to bring benefit and bring goods and life and trade to people. And that very thing they were going to try to achieve, they became the blockage for that. Apparently a 12th, 1 in 8 of all trade in the world passes through the Suez Canal. And yet the very ship that was there to aid it becomes the very blockage to that. God's plan was that the Jewish people under the law would be the means of grace and blessing to the world. And yet the irony is the same. They became the very blockage to God's intent. Says that there's a physical family, the descendants of Abraham. Says in verses 7 and 8, it was all laid out beforehand in Scripture that God would set things right with non-Jews by faith. Scripture anticipated this in the promise to Abraham, all nations will be blessed in you. But the irony in the story is that the church in Galatia, initially so dedicated to this gospel of Jesus Christ, had slipped back into a legal, law-based way of operating. Just like in the sea parable, and those lifesavers who were there initially, full of the vim and the zeal and the enthusiasm to go out and save people, end up sitting comfortably in their beautiful clubhouse, now disinterested in what they were there to do. I wonder what went through their heads at that time. What influences, what pressures were amongst them to change their perspective? Perhaps it was that they had increased resources available and could build themselves this wonderful clubhouse. Perhaps they were tired of the efforts they made in the past and they'd worked so tirelessly now, they were just exhausted. Perhaps there was some kind of selfish inclination towards comfort. They'd much rather do that. And they had increasing disinclination to go out and risk themselves and get wet and perhaps injured in the work of life-saving as others. There's a slide, there's a drift that takes place, and it caused a blockage for those in the film, and it's caused a blockage for the church in Galatia. But the blockage is removed. Verses 13 and 14, Peterson translates this way. Christ redeemed us from that self-defeating cursed life by absorbing it completely into himself. This is what happened when Jesus was nailed to the cross. He became a curse and at the same time dissolved the curse. So two things happen at this point. Christ comes and perfectly does what you and I couldn't do. The law wasn't the problem. It was our fulfillment of the law. One emerges who perfectly fulfills the law. Jesus Christ, the sinless one. We sing, don't we? Because the sinless Saviour died, my sinful soul is counted free. Because of what Jesus does, it has a transforming effect on our lives. That happens. And also, therefore, reconciliation with God, being at peace with God again, is no longer achieved through fulfilling these laws, but is now open to all people, because it's about simply accepting in faith what Jesus Christ has done for us. And any division, any ethnic divides that may have existed between Jews and Gentiles, are completely gone because of what Jesus has done and faith in him. It's another news story from the week, a cycling one this time. Probably don't know this cyclist. His name is Biniam Gurme, and he's from Eritrea. And this week, he became the first black African man to win a stage in one of the three biggest cycle races in the world. So the race for 3 weeks in Italy, Spain, and the Tour de France. He won on one day one of the stages in Italy. First time a black African man has done it. And you see his utter delight. And as I messaged on social media, there was lots of other people who were equally delighted by this news, because basically what's happening is that a barrier has now been broken down. Biniam Gurme has opened things up for black African riders. There are very few of them, but there are some on the professional circuit. And that ethnic barrier has been broken down. Unfortunately, though, straight after winning the stage, he did the thing that you do with the cycle races. You get your bottle of, well, in Italy, it's Prosecco, not champagne. So he shook up his bottle, and he's grabbing his face because he fired the cork into his eye, so that when the national anthem was sung, he kind of stood there squinting with one eye closed, went to hospital, and he's damaged his eye, he's out of the race. So that was the sad irony of it. But Biniam Gurmay broke the blockage. He removed it. And Paul tells us about a barrier being broken. And so where does that leave us? Well, the law was given. Keeping the law, well, the Jewish nation failed that. It became a blockage. But that blockage was removed by Jesus Christ. But what do the Galatians do? They go back to the law. That's why the opening line we read in chapter 3, Eugene Peterson translates, "You crazy Galatians." I wonder what it says in your version. I looked up others. It says, "You foolish Galatians, you stupid Galatians, you witless Galatians." It's pulling no punches there, is it? Paul is utterly incensed by the fact that they're going back to the way things used to be. Just a few years before this, the Galatian church had grasped the wonder of the grace and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. But as Andrew explained to us last week, standing here, the church in Galatia had been influenced by that other great heavyweight in the early church, not Paul here writing, but Peter, and also by the church in Rome that kind of was a bit nervy about what was going on, and had gone back to trusting the law. What that meant basically was the three things we'd cited earlier in the series. They'd gone back to festivals, gone back to the food rituals, and got back to circumcision, the markers of Jewish faith. And Paul is tearing his hair out because of what they have done in returning to these things. What a travesty. What a denial of what Jesus has done. I remember hearing a story some years ago of a speaker who was invited to talk at a university Christian union. And he went and he spoke on the subject of Mark chapter 10, the rich young ruler. So he's got all these bright, rich young people in front of him. That would be an appropriate story. So he tells this story and obviously gets to the crescendo where the young man asks Jesus, "What must I do to have eternal life?" And Jesus says, "You need to sell your possessions and give the proceeds to the poor and then come and follow me." After he'd finished, the speaker is packing up his stuff in his bag and putting things away. And a young man came up to speak to him. The young man had a bit of a smile on his face. He was quite a bright young man. He was a bit cocky, perhaps. And he commended the speaker on his message. And the speaker said, "Thank you." And he said, "Yes, great, that story that you told about this rich young man. But I was just wondering, What must I do to have eternal life? What about me? What must I do?" And the speaker looked up at him, he was putting things away, and glanced up and said, "There's nothing you can do." And the young man, not put off by this, said, no, come on, no, come on. What must I do to have eternal life?" And the guy looked up at him again and said, "There's nothing you can do. Nothing you can do." And he's a little bit rattled by now, and he's kind of, his smile had gone from his face, and he looked quite seriously at the speaker and said, "No, come on, seriously, what must I do to have eternal life?" And the guy stopped and looked him in the eye and said, "There is nothing that you can do to have eternal life, because Jesus Christ has done everything." And that's what Paul is trying to say to these pesky Galatians. Don't go back to that way of living. Don't go back to the rule book. There is nothing you can do because Jesus Christ has done it all for you. I think that's not something simply that people who are coming to faith might struggle with. Just accepting that really there's nothing they can do. Like, they don't have to kind of pray to be in God's good books or read the Bible or help people cross the road or whatever you're supposed to do. But some people struggle over the idea you just have to accept what Jesus Christ has done for you. But equally, I think that as we carry on as believers, a bit like the Galatian church, there's a danger of slipping back into a way of thinking, well, perhaps there is stuff that I need to do, there is stuff that I should do, that is, you know, the Christian stuff to do, and we lose touch with this message and the way like the Galatian church were losing touch. I think that the change that happens to us once we've come to faith, as we grow as disciples and followers of Jesus, I've said it before, I think the change happens in three ways. The change happens because we learn the Bible and we learn the teachings of the Bible and particularly of Jesus. That's what changes us. We're changed by the Holy Spirit working in our lives. It's not about our own personal effort. It's the Spirit of Jesus Christ working in us. And thirdly, I think we're changed, I'm changed, by being part of the Christian community, which delivers me from all the fantasies and fallacies that I have about life, and you knock the rough edges off me, and you help me to be more Christ-like. The Bible, the Spirit, and being part of the redeeming community of Jesus Christ. Perhaps the lifesavers in the film started out thankful, saved people, but somehow they drifted towards, I don't know, comfort, ease, rules, barriers. Because when you think of it, if you set up rules and barriers, you could be much more dependent on just a set of rules than on Jesus Christ or on God or on the Spirit. Because Jesus Christ will always do something you don't expect. And that kind of is a bit freaky. Jesus, who would go around welcoming children. Jesus, who would go and eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners. Jesus, who would, the pension thing, upset the financial markets of the day in the temple. Jesus, who had the audacity to forgive somebody on the cross next to him. If you end up trusting Jesus, it's a lot more difficult than trusting a set of laws. And it's very tempting to go back to that way. I know that temptation. I was thinking about what I would share if I was. There was time for me to say something today. I would tell you this. I would tell you that over the last 2 years, and it's only just become settling in my mind now, the greatest work of God in my life over the last 2 years has been to deliver me from thinking that what happens is dependent on my hard work, my graft, my intellect, my efforts, my trying to be good, and actually realize that the transformation that's needed is solely dependent on the work of God and his Spirit in the life of the church and in individuals. I've had to go through a bit of a journey on that. So this passage is, I think, about blockages and roadblocks and obstacles. It's about the faithful, believing church who misjudge and misconstrue things, who in trying to do the very right thing, do the very wrong thing that they claim they shouldn't do. Maybe think about what are the roadblocks today. I hope and think that we're long past the idea that there are ethnic distinctions in Christian living. I also think there is no difference between us sitting in church today, fundamentally, and the people who have been walking past this building for the past hour who have got no mind for God whatsoever. We are the same human beings. The only difference is that by faith we've accepted what God has done for us. If you were to ask Paul here today the question, what do you need to become part of ABC? What do you need to do to join the church family? What do you think Paul would say? What do you think Paul would say? One little line in the sea parable that may have passed you by was this line. Can't read up there, but it's about being cleaned up before coming inside. I think about my neighbours who I'm always talking to and seeing them come to faith. Think about the people that I bump into or see in the hub each week, the people who stand in front of me or behind me in the bread and butter thing queue. Think about CAP clients. Think about all the Ukrainians who spend time in this building in the hub each week. Think about Rebecca Vardy. I would baptize any of those people on profession of faith, and that's it. I would welcome into this church any of those people on profession of faith. That's all. That's all. One last thing, and it's my thing behind me. So here's a little confession for you, and it is a little confession. A few weeks ago, Rachel mentioned that one of the art community groups in Altrincham were doing an event to celebrate the Queen's Jubilee. Great, I'm doing one in. So Rachel just says yes to everything, so said, yeah, we're in. So we got presented with a life-size fiberglass corgi, as in the dog the Queen has. And the thing is, though, we needed to decorate it and make it beautiful. Something that was about a bit about us, something that was a bit about the Royal Jubilee and everything, so thought, great. So Rachel came to the church art expert, self-professed or whatever, and said, yeah, what can we do with this? So I thought, I had these great, fantastic, highfalutin ideas, and I'll show you. So in my head, one of my first thoughts was, let's be really cool. These are the official Paul Smith designer stripes. What if we cover the corgi in Paul Smith's designer stripes? I mean, that's going to take ages, isn't it? But it would look really cool. But anyway, so that was like where I went to first. Then I kind of thought, we've got this kind of curvy shape. How are you going to put an image on a curvy shape? So I then went to Grayson Perry, the artist, the British artist, who does lots of things with ceramics. So I went, let's kind of paint things on the shape of the corgi, and we could do this really cool thing, and it would take ages, but it'd be really cool, and thought about that. And that one didn't pass muster either. That one didn't stack up. What we came up with was, as I was kind of working through this, was something that I'd seen just a few weeks before on a wall in an airport. And I'd seen this, which is, believe it or not, a famous, internationally renowned designer and artist who on a wall has painted all these faces called How Are You This Morning? And I thought, well, perhaps the community thing, we could start doing something like that and get people to put faces on it. And so it was agreed that we're going to get the dog and we're going to get red and blue paint, red, white, and blue, yeah, on the white dog, and we're going to do this. So let me present to you where we are up to. I went and pitched this morning. Ooh. It's believe it or not, my own dog saw this and sniffed its bottom. Okay. Here is our dog. Our corgi. I think apparently we call it Hubster, is its name. Thing is, I want to give you a close-up. So here's a picture of it. In no sense does what's been painted on that dog come anywhere close to Paul Smith's stripes, Grayson Perry's ceramics, or perhaps even the internationally renowned artist's plan for the wall of the airport in Copenhagen. So we've done that. There was a bit of a mishap at the rear end of the dog as well, which is on this. But you know what? This is absolutely right and true. Because this has been painted on by, I'm on there, staff team are on there, volunteers are on there, people who are queuing up to get their food from the bread and butter thing, they're on there. Ukrainian kids painted stuff on here. That's what's represented on here. And it's not beautiful, it's not exact, it's not going to win any awards, but this is absolutely true to what we should be doing. And going back to some kind of rule book where we define everything and we don't allow people to come with their mess, I think is a big problem for me. This, if Jesus was standing here, he would embrace this and love this and be grateful for this. And I think in some way that's what Paul's trying to tell the church in Galatians. And we have to decide whether that's what God is saying to us as a church today. Let's pray together. So once again, Father, we look at an ancient text and we try to get at the meaning and we seek to apply it to our lives today. And Lord, I know that if I control things, if I set down laws and define things clearly, it helps me to be in control, it helps me to feel safer. And yet over the last 2 years, you've been teaching me to let go and let God do things that I wouldn't in ways that I don't like. We pray for our church and for our lives at this time, for what God is doing. And we pray, Lord, that you would spare us from the temptation to legislate anything beyond your grace, your work, anything beyond the teaching of the Bible, the work of your Spirit, the redeeming effect of the community, and that you would have your way in each of us and in this church family. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Shall we stand for our final song?
Mountains open deep. Face the guilty world in
love. It's good. We're there. Hi, everyone. My name is Rob. I'm the youth worker, pastor, person here, for you who do not know me. I'm a very visual person, and God often talks to me through pictures. And this may be a picture from God, it may be not, but considering what we've just sang and what like Ash was talking about, I feel like it is. So, Helen, I was singing, I promise, but I also was creating space for God at the beginning because I'd just been running around like, whoa, this morning, and then I stopped. But I felt like I got this picture from God of a stone gate sort of opening, and it felt like there was like a sort of like a waterway after the stone gate, and it looked very dry, the waterway, and as the stone gate opened, it opened a little bit and then kind of shut again, and a little bit of water came out and trickled out, and it reminded me, and this is Rob ad-libbing probably at this point, but it reminded me of this time. And just one more thing before I say this. Eugene Peterson also said that stories are like a verbal act of hospitality. So you can use that one going forward. Anyway, here's my verbal act of hospitality for you. I was in Pitlochry last year, and there's a hydroelectric dam, as you guys will all know, I'm sure. And the first day I went, it was open really wide, and there was loads of water coming out of this sluice gate. Is sluice gate the right word? Yes, Ash is saying sluice gate is the right word. And the next day I went, it was only open a little bit, and a little bit was coming out. And it felt like, although the law is a barrier that we cannot overcome, we often put our own barriers up to allowing God into our lives. And actually, God wants us to open up whatever that sluice gate, whatever those barriers are, and allow him to flow through us. And that might be difficult. We may not know what those barriers are. We may know what those barriers are, but it may be difficult to open them up. So I would say that this week, if you guys have barriers, just ask God to help you with those barriers. And if there's barriers that you don't know about, but you feel like you're not connected with God, or you feel quite dry, maybe ask God what those barriers are. So that's what I felt was God was saying to us, so yeah.
Hey, thank you. Encouraging. Let's just pray, shall we? And perhaps you either put your hands out or metaphorically put your hands out to say that, Lord, we receive from you whatever you're saying to us at this time. We haven't come here to be reminded of something we already knew. We haven't come here because that's what we do on a Sunday. We've come here to meet with you and hear from you and learn from you and be transformed by you. Lord, any of the things that we've thought or heard today which are not significant, not part of what you're saying, we pray that you might blow them away like chaff. But all that which is good and true and resident is true to what you are saying to the church. We pray that we might receive it. In Jesus' name, amen.